Good morning. Thank you for coming. My name is Alice Hamilton. Dr. Orford asked me to introduce our distinguished speakers. So I'm actually very busy, but I found the time to get here. I'm not that far at Hull House. I took Uber over, so I got here pretty fast. And once I'm done, I'm actually going to have to go to the phosphorus mines because it's a terrible time for industrial medicine, these poor workers with phossy jaw. So I'm going to see what I can do for them. But here I am now, and this is the third of four of the series of History of Occupational Medicine put on by the History and Archives section. And this section is entitled The Evolution of Occupation and Environmental Medicine. Our first speaker is Dr. Hartenbaum, who needs no introduction. She will talk about transportation medicine. She's a diplomat of the American Board of Internal Medicine and Preventive Medicine and Occupational Medicine, with a lot of experience in corporate, clinical, and academic settings, and a nationally recognized expert in occupational fitness for duty and a special focus on transportation. She is the President and Chief Medical Officer of Occumedics, editor of the DOT Medical Examination, a guide to commercial driver medical certification now in its fifth edition. She has published and lectured nationally, and she's also adjunct faculty at the University of Pennsylvania and serves as medical director for several companies. A past president, welcome.
Well, thank you, Alice. And I think back in the olden days, we had lots of transportation issues. And, you know, what was really fun about being asked to do this when we got this together, I was saying, okay, we do a lot of DOT exams, we do some railroad work, but how did it all start and where did this come from? So some of this may have been covered in some of the other sessions. I know that a lot of the early occupational physicians were railroad docs, so they were aviation docs. So I'm going to touch a little bit on those two topics, but we're going to really get a little bit more into the background on how did the Department of Transportation, Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration, get to where we are right now, and it certainly has not been a smooth path, and it's not going to be going forward. So my disclosure, so, you know, the biggest piece really is highway, as I talked about, from what most of us do. And, you know, where did the whole medical concern about truck or bus drivers start? Well, it started back in 1939. And some of you may have heard me talk about the date significance, June 7th. Remember that date, it pops up a couple times. And the requirements for the Interstate Commerce Commission, which is what managed the medical issues, was good physical and mental health, good eyesight, adequate hearing, no addiction to narcotic drugs, and no excessive use of alcoholic beverages or liquors. So it wasn't that they can't be drinking, it wasn't that they couldn't be doing drugs, it just they couldn't be doing too much of it. So when did we start examining the drivers? Well, we weren't examining the drivers in 1939, we weren't examining them until 1954. And that's when the physical examination certificate was very first required. And this is I don't have my thingy, but we talk about the Federal Highway Administration talks about the very first medical qualifications. What date was that published on the proposed standard? June 7th, 1969. So 30 years from when they first said that there's a requirement, did we finally begin to say, okay, how do we examine them? What are those actual physical requirements? Back then, insulin was not disqualifying. We're almost coming that full circle again. Insulin is disqualifying only if it's within the last 12 months back in 1969. And now it's going to be able to be qualified once again, getting rid of the exemption program. The blood pressure, 160 over 90. And it remained 160 over 90 for quite a long time. Audiometric criterion was only 30 decibel loss. Now we know a 40 and then the annual exam. 1970. The Department of Transportation was finally created, and that's when the responsibility for the commercial drivers was pushed into the Department of Transportation. The final rule came out on April 22nd. Moved from annual to biannual exams. The blood pressure was only disqualifying, again, not by a number, as we talked about yesterday, but only if it was likely to interfere with the driver's ability to safely operate a commercial motor vehicle. So once again, that 140 over 90, 160 over 90 really never was regulatory. It was always just kind of that, as long as they're not impaired, they're probably okay. And then only current use of insulin. So if they were using insulin 6 months ago, 2 months ago, they still could be qualified. what was significant about June 7th, I've mentioned that twice as I was doing my research, is that happens to be my birthday. So it kind of seems serendipitous that here I am getting involved in highway medical issues when two of the big rulemakings came out on my birthday, some of them years before I was born, though. So a little more background. 1971, the hearing standard was changed, where they allowed hearing aids. The average hearing loss was increased so that they could, as long as they could hear to at least 40 decibels. Now, we know we're now being granted hearing exemptions. And what's even more interesting is we talked yesterday about, are we creating regulations that really make sense? Studies were done that showed most drivers, even if they do have adequate hearing, can't hear what's going on in the cab anyway because it's too noisy. So we have really nice hearing standards, hearing exemptions, but they can't hear because it's too noisy in the truck anyway. This is the date that most of us hate, July 28, 1992. The definition of an examiner was changed from a physician to any licensed healthcare professional. And the way they defined it, why it didn't really matter and why it didn't have to be a physician was because the physical examination does not require sophisticated diagnosis or treatment. In the event that such diagnostic analysis is required, the FHWA would expect that the healthcare professional, consistent with sound medical practices, to promptly refer the patient to the appropriate healthcare specialist. That's what guides us right now in having the other licensed healthcare professionals on the National Registry and evaluating the fitness for duty for our commercial motor vehicle operators. 92, 93, we got vision waivers and diabetes waivers. And it really hasn't shown that there's been an increased number of crashes in those individuals who were in that waiver program, eventually morphed into the exemption programs. Now, as I look around the room, I suspect a few of you may recognize this. A few of you may actually recognize the back page. The problem was it was a two-sided form, and we very rarely would see the back side of the form because the employer just sent us the first side. So we had no idea that the regulations and then the advisory criteria, at that time called the medical advisory criteria, were actually even included. And this form, can I steal your thunder for 1 second? One fun thing about this form is a little statement there says, examined in accordance with subpart H or not in accordance with subpart H. At this time, you actually had the drug testing as part of the medical examination. So the question came up yesterday of, I'm the MRO and I'm the examiner, do I have to wait for the drug test results to come back? And the answer back then was, yeah, if it was part of the exam, because we were doing the periodics. Now, totally separate, we don't deal with it at all. Things have changed a little bit. So what else has been happening over the past couple of decades? 1996 to 1998, my first real introduction to the Federal Motor Carrier, Federal Highway Administration's rulemaking process. We all like to think that change happens because it makes sense. I learned change happens because there's not enough people arguing against having it happen. And this was negotiated at the Rulemaking Committee, and the whole plan was, doesn't this sound really good, develop an administrative process to combine the medical examination and the commercial driver's license and turn it over to the states, improve the quality of the exams, make certain that the states oversee the form, eliminate examiner shopping, and wouldn't that have been perfect? Three types of proposal, the FAA system. FAA system seems to be working, why don't we do the same thing? The third one was what ACOEM proposed, require mandatory training and then a series of questions and answers demonstrating knowledge to all examiners. And then you had the middle ground recommendation. I'm not going to tell you which kind of licensed healthcare professionals recommended that, but they were the ones that also fought very hard against any kind of training and testing. And it was, well, how about if we sign a statement that I'll do the exam the right way? Okay? Those of you who know me can just imagine when I stood up and said, what the do you think you're signing when you're signing the certificate? You're signing that you're doing the examination in accordance with the regulations and guidelines. And they just kind of looked at me and like, but we'll sign a statement that we're doing it right. You already are. Needless to say, the committee ended in 1998 and nothing happened. It sounds very reminiscent of the Medical Review Board, which had their first meeting and listened to their first expert panel in 2007. And how many of those recommendations from the medical expert panel, medical review boards, have actually made it into official FMCSA guidance? Zero. Rulemaking, it's a great process. It doesn't go anywhere very quickly. So continuing on, January 2000, the FMCSA was created, taking over the medical regulation, the safety regulation responsibility from the Federal Highway Administration. In 2000, we had the new examination form. And in 2003, we finally have new cardiac guidelines. Guess what? That's the first guidelines that we've had updated since the mid-1990s. And we're still working on those same 2003 cardiac guidelines. Nothing has changed in cardiology in 12 years, right? We got technical amendments, not really significant, and an updated form once again. And then safety LU. This was going to be our savior. The Safe and Efficient Transportation Equity Act of the 21st Century, a legacy for users. In 2005, the users are still waiting. Medical Review Board, it's been great. Has it been effective? Chief Medical Officer, that was really nice for the time it lasted. I think she then ran away as fast as she could when she realized what was going on. Jobs been posted, taken down, posted again. There's still no Chief Medical Officer. Diabetes exemption was started, and there is indeed finally a National Registry of Certified Medical Examiners. But if we look at the upper right-hand corner, that's it in 2006, and it says, we expect the NRCME to be fully implemented within the year. Not quite. And that's just the proposed rule. Proposed rule for the National Registry, 2008. So when everyone's saying, why can't these regulations happen faster? Why can't we see change happening? Why isn't? This just gives you a really good example of how slow change really is. Medical Review Board, medical expert panels, medical examiner's handbook began. Of course, now we know that medical examiner's handbook is gone. And then that chief medical officer, which came and went. Well, these are historical documents, and yes, I am a pack rat, and yes, I still have these documents in my file cabinet. Paper versions, wow. 1987, 1988, 1991, 1991, and guess what? The information from these historical paper documents are what was used to create the medical examiner handbook that we are all so upset is no longer on the website. The truth is, we probably should be very thankful it's no longer on the website, because it's pretty far out of date. I think a lot has changed in psychiatric disorder since 1991. So again, the handbook, you know, we've got to remember that it's being updated and it's only meant as a guideline to examiners. Problem is, we have all kinds of examiners, some who know what they're doing and a lot who just simply don't. So what about the National Registry? Where are we going for that one? Well, the CDL and the medical certificate notice of proposed rulemaking back in 2006. When did that finally happen? 2012. The NPRM on the National Registry, 2008. Proposed rule, final rule. We're still looking at that final National Registry Part 2. Proposed in 2013, pushed off a couple of times, and April 20th, so 8 days from now, National Registry Part 2 will finally go fully into effect almost 3 years after the proposed rule. So that's a little bit about highway, how we got here. What about rail? There's a lot more history on rail, a lot of good history on rail surgeons and railway doctors. But why did we need, and Tia, I think we touched on, or Bob, on railway doctors in some of the other sessions as well. You know, railway doctors were really the company doctor. They were the ones who were treating those railroad workers who were working in the middle of nowhere, who kept getting injured. And you want to try to keep them healthy, you want to keep them on the railroad, you had to keep them working. And if you didn't take care of them where they were, there wasn't anybody else around. So the railway surgeons really kind of came out of that transcontinental railroad, where people were in the middle of nowhere, and they needed something to take care of them. And as I mentioned, they were the original company doctor back in 1849. So ACOEM kind of goes back a long, long time. And the first Railway Medical Association, the Surgical Society of the Wabash, St. Louis at Pacific Railroad, east of the Mississippi. Very long name, was founded in 1882. So the company doctor is not a new creation, especially when you look at the railroad. They treated infectious disease that was spreading across the country due to the Transcontinental Railroad, and that really led to the development of railroad medical organizations. And if you're interested in railroad medical history, that's a really good article. There's a number of different articles, some of them available through Google Books and all that. The first organization, 1887, met in Chicago, 1988. So Chicago has a lot of history when it comes to occupational medicine and related organizations. Textbook, 1890. And then the biweekly first journal, The Railway Surgeon, began in 1894. Canada and Mexico became involved, and we then had the International Association of Railroad Surgeons. a rival organization, just like ACOEM and the Academy merging. We had two railroad organizations merged in 1904 to become the American Association of Railroad Surgeons, which now known as the AAR, has their medical section. American Association of Railroads has their kind of informal medical group, I think. Railroad surgeons went from small medical on-site clinics to very large medical facilities and even hospitals in some cases, where the hospitals were not just treating the railroad workers, but the community and the employees and employees' families as well. The hospital is very progressive. The Southern Pacific San Francisco facility was the second hospital in the country to open an intensive care unit, and others had nurses training programs and other types of professional training programs. There was some decline in railway surgery, with the railway surgeon changing its name. The last railroad hospital closed in the early 1970s, and we still have the railway surgeon kind of legacy journal is Occupational Health and Safety. So there's still a little bit left in the railroad. Now in the FRA, a little bit of regulatory side of it, 1966 is when the Federal Railroad Administration first came into existence. And the Rail Safety Advisory Committee was established in 1996, with the Medical Standards Work Group began in 2006-2005. At that time, medical standards for railroad workers were proposed, and it's still being worked on, and it hasn't really gone very far. There was some revised standards for locomotive engineers on their vision standards in 1999. And included in those railroad standards, the vision standard modifications, was how do you test for color vision? That was a result of a crash that happened because of the engineers failing color vision. What's really interesting to see how progressive we are, guidance came out on how to address the vision, color vision, the actual instructions on how to do the color vision testing came out last year. It took a little bit of time. There were some safety advisory groups that came out, safety advisors that came out on prescription and over-the-counter medications, and then on sleep operations. And they talked about making certain that railroad operators have sufficient sleep and don't have sleep apnea. That was way back in 2004. Some of you may have heard about the announcement of proposed advance notice of proposed rulemaking that came out recently on sleep apnea for the FRA. So in 2004, the railroad came out with an advisory criteria or advisory document, safety advisory on sleep apnea. 2016, they're finally thinking about making a rule about it. So it takes a really long time. And then in 2011, the medical criteria, which existed prior only for locomotive engineers or those that were remote control operators, then extended to the conductors. Still does not cover most of the safety-sensitive railroad operators. It is only the conductors and engineers at this point. This is the book I mentioned earlier, the little booklet, 2005, looking at medical standards for railroad workers. We still do not have overall medical standards for railroad workers, only vision, hearing, and color vision. And as I like to joke and say, any of which can be waived by a combination of the designated supervisor of locomotive engineers and a physician who evaluates the individual. That's the medical history in the railroad. Aviation. Now, much as we'd love to see highway mirroring aviation, it would be really great. Problem is, it's a very different size of employees, kind of about a 10-fold difference in numbers, actually 100-fold different in numbers. It's very difficult to have the exact same system, given the amount of resources available for the agencies. Lots and lots of documented books and histories on the history and development of aviation medicine. Again, we have aviation medicine. We have railroad medicine. We don't really have bus and truck medicine. Maybe, but not really. The father of aviation medicine was a French physiologist, Paul Bert, in 1862, who proved that the high altitude effects were due to decreased partial pressure of oxygen. Back in those days, somebody looked at the effect of fatigue and reaction time. Thank you, I am getting there. And the Germans then looked at psychological fitness. So a lot of the origins of aviation medicine was not US, it was really over in Europe. In 1912, the War Department issued its first instructions for examination of candidates for flying, and the medical director of aeronautics went into the US Department of Commerce, and that was Louis Bauer. And a lot of just, you know, evolution and growing and changing and trying to get to some reasonable standards and reasonable criteria. And Dr. Bauer was considered kind of the real beginning of aviation medicine. And Bob, you probably can talk a lot more about aviation medicine than I can even begin to, but it kind of fits in there. And there was the Aeromedical Association, which morphed in over the years to the Aerospace Medical Association. They had their own journal, and he became the president of the American Medical Association. So we have kind of the transportation doc leading the AMA way back when. And then 1926 textbook on aviation medicine. So aviation medicine goes back a pretty decent amount of time here, even in the U.S. The FAA Act of 1958 established the Office of the Civil Air Surgeon. And through that, we then became the Civil Aerospace Medical Institute. CAMI is still in existence. And through CAMI is where a lot of the aviation worker certifications is held. Very briefly on aviation. Now, maritime, wish we had a lot more on maritime, but we don't. The U.S. Coast Guard, 1790. So they go back a long time. Unfortunately, the medical issues really didn't go back quite that long. In 1946, we had our first maritime section and navigation statements. That was transferred in 1946. And then we had regional exam centers in 1982. So we're starting to examine to see whether or not our maritime workers are safe, 1982. In 1997, we began to merge the Coast Guard Merchant Mariner licensing programs and began to look more at the medical issues. And then we had the really nice crash in 2003, which led the National Transportation Safety Board to make some recommendations to the Coast Guard saying, you know, someone's got to look at these physical exams and make certain that these mariners are healthy and safe rather than just being done wherever they're done. And some new information did come out in 2004, which provided some additional guidance to those who were evaluating the mariners. I see my little timing thing there. Transit. As I keep saying, different transit on its own really has no medical standards. The only thing the transit is really, really good at is medications. And if you want to find out about medications and medical fitness, the FTA has those really good information, the circulars and the prescription over-the-counter toolkit. So in summary, now that I got in my slip, the history of transportation medicine is long if you're looking at aviation. It's long if you're looking at rail. It's not so great when you're looking at highway, and it's certainly kind of non-existent when you're looking at transit. So change happens very, very slowly. It doesn't always happen linearly, and it often will go back and repeat some of the same issues of the past. So that's a brief overview of transportation.
Thank you, Dr. Hartenbaum. I think we have time for a couple questions.
Which, when I step back two steps and look at the thing, it raises the question, if I put it a little sharply, are we actually necessary? Because obviously nothing happens. And if we have no regulation for 30 years, obviously it was not a bad thing. So to put it bluntly, how important are we as occupational docs for these business of work examination?
Depends on who you talk to. This all comes down to an issue. The question was, are we really necessary? It all comes down to what's the acceptable risk. And if the acceptable risk is there is never a highway, bus, truck, aviation crash, then no, there's probably no value in examining anybody. The problem is you have one catastrophic train crash or one plane crash, and suddenly you've got to do something. So we're very reactionary. Does it decrease the number of crashes because we don't allow the insulin-dependent diabetic to drive? Probably. But does it also take people off the road who probably would never crash? On some of the other regulations, though, it's important for us to be involved with this rulemaking so that we can influence the change. The National Registry came about because there were occupational physicians involved with guiding some of the right things to do. Part of the reason why the licensed healthcare professional wording came about, no one said anything. No one did anything. Might it have made a difference? No. But might it have influenced slightly how it was worded? Possibly, yes. And I know even with the veterans regulations coming down now through the FAST Act, we're looking at letting the VA docs examine the vets without having to go through the full form of training. There was some wording that we were able to influence to get into that, where they do need to have the appropriate knowledge. So it's not just a carte blanche, you're a VA doc, go examine. So, yeah, it's important for us to influence. It just may take forever.
Okay, one more question.
John, I guess. I think John's hand was slightly faster than yours.
So I'm in the railroad industry, and the thing is, even if we have very few regulations, and as Natalie said, we even have to justify decisions we make with those regulations.
Yeah.
Because it not only gives us the power to kind of make a decision, it gives our employees the power to challenge everything we say. So, but we still are responsible, and we do 12,000 fitness for duty evaluations a year, you know, our 40,000 employees. And so I think you still find, you still have to go to the evidence, and you still have to like look at what the other agencies say, the other member agencies that you have to say. And then what happens is, as an employer, you just have to defend all your decisions. So if we had a good regulation, it would be easier to defend it, because they were doing it with the regulation. But I think you still have to do the right thing as an employer. And the occupational medicine physicians are very much needed. We're very busy. It's just we have to defend everything.
And I was given permission that Warner can ask his question.
You know, just a comment for Warner. In a session of the administrative there in San Francisco yesterday, the number of fatal highway crashes has decreased enormously since certification of medical examiners. He presented data that had the number of thousands going way down.
That's been overall crashes, but the fatal truck crashes, whether it was the exams, probably not, whether it was highway factors or a lot of other factors involved. I don't.
Sure, it's an association, but the number applies, right? I think it would be worth reciting those numbers that you have.
I'll pull them up if there's a break.
Okay, thank you. So, while I get this up, so for those of you who came in late, my name is Alice Hamilton. Dr. Orford asked me to introduce the distinguished guests. So, I found time in my busy schedule. I took Uber over here from Hull House. So thank you all for coming. Our next speaker is Dr. Lepke. Dr. Lepke is vice chairman of the U.S. Preventive Medicine and serves as co-chair of the company's International Advisory Board. He is a diplomat of the American Board of Preventive Medicine and also a fellow of ACOEM and ACPM. He's past president of ACOEM, another past president, giving a presentation on the history of our occupational medicine, and co-chair of the International Occupational Medicine Society Collaborative. He's also co-chair of the ACOEM Section on Health and Productivity, and chairman of the CDC Diabetes at Work Group, and also the National Diabetes Education Program for the NIH. So welcome. Okay, so do you want to go? Okay, so we also have Drs. Peterson and Smith, who will talk about substance abuse prevention and screening. Dr. Peterson is the president of Occupational Strategist Consulting Firm. He's also medical director of Examinetics. He did ask me to keep his bio brief, so I will try. His reputation precedes him, of course. He's the director of the Executive Wellness Program at the Federal Executive Institute and designed and directed ACOEM's Drug and Alcohol Testing Medical Review Officer course since 1990. He's a founder and member of the Board of Directors of the Medical Review Officer Certification Council and also a past president of ACOEM. He's authored several books and scientific publications. And Dr. Smith is the Program Development and Regulatory Compliance Officer of Employers Drug Program Management. She holds a doctorate in education as well as counseling psychology with a concentration in addictions. Before 1995, she was the Director of Drug Enforcement and Program Compliance within the Office of the Secretary of the U.S. Department of Transportation. While at the DOT, Dr. Smith was one of the principal authors of the DOT drug and alcohol testing rules. She has served as program administrator for drug testing programs in professional athletics under the International Olympic Committee and Anti-Doping Protocol, and has taught the ACOEM MRO course since 1992. So welcome, both of you.
So do I hit any key to advance or down? Go. Well, good morning, everybody. Pleasure to be here. Originally, I was asked to join the other two past presidents to describe this, and I thought, wow, what an amazing opportunity we have to add Dr. Smith to the panel, because how often do you have a chance to actually talk about history with somebody who's played such a significant role in making history? So I asked Donna if she would join with me, and so together we're going to be going back and forth as we cover the history of substance abuse, prevention, and screening. We have no financial conflict of interest, and I want to just sort of give you an overview of what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk, first of all, about substance use and abuse, because if you're going to prevent it and screen it, presumably there needs to be some evidence about a problem. Second, we will talk about prevention, and then finally about screening. So there's three key segments here. There'll be about 10 minutes each. And we'll speak about it both generally, but we'll also briefly speak about it in terms of sports, another segment on military, where actually the term medical review officer came from, and our biggest emphasis will be on the workplace. So let's begin with the whole question of substance use and abuse. Obviously, we human beings are substance users. Clear documentation of alcohol use going back to the early Egyptians, narcotics a few thousand years BC, and cannabinoids even a millennium before that in Asia. Plant substances were used by all kinds of people, from those who treated people with illness to ordinary citizens, and out of plants really came the scientific field of pharmacology that has emerged. But going back, for example, to the Civil War era, morphine kits were issued to soldiers during the Civil War. If you got shot, probably could not be treated, at least you could die with less pain. After the Civil War, an ingenious pharmacist in Atlanta decided to have a soda fountain drink which incorporated some of the wonderful news about the drugs, the leaves that were coming from this cocoa plant in Peru. And so Coca-Cola containing cocaine became widely popularized as a soda fountain drink, and it rapidly spread and continues to have its headquarters in Atlanta, even though the cocaine was taken out. So in this period, which we could call the patent medicine era, from the 1980s through the early 1990s, we also had opium dens flourishing in the United States. For example, laudanum, which was a tincture of opium, was widely used as a household remedy. Grandmother could not drink alcohol, but she could certainly drink the tincture of laudanum to help prop her up. So you see amazing advertisements for belladonna, poison hemlock oil, mandrake root, essence of devil's apple, and wolfbane. So patent medicines abounded, and here are just some pictures of laudanum coming from the Black Phoenix Alchemy Lab. Sounds a little like the 1960s, doesn't it? So, of course, that led to a series of legislative efforts, and that ended the patent medicine era. Now we move into the modern era, and Donna is going to pick up from here.
So as Kent mentioned, I think it's kind of interesting to look at his pictures of the patent medicine. And yesterday, he showed some slides that showed various cannabis and marijuana shops in Denver, Colorado. And so now, instead of, you know, the elixir of whatever, we have cannabis gummy bears and gums and cakes, etc. So maybe we've just kind of come full circle. But in the 1950s and 60s was really when marijuana became identified, as well as other drugs. In terms of use, was rising among a new generation of users, and it was also obviously a time of tremendous upheaval from a political and a social perspective. It was in the 1970s that the NIDA, the National Institute on Drug Abuse, in response to a lot of the political movement about what we needed to do about drug use and abuse in this country, they began an extensive survey instrument to take a look at what was the prevalence, what was of illegal drug use, and that survey then has expanded now. It continues to go as the National Survey on Drug Use and Health. And it continues to be a bellwether marker for what are people using in terms of drugs of abuse, what impact does it have on their lives. Again, it's all self-report data. It's a stratified random sample. But it has continued to give us a way to look at things now over, you know, over four decades. The sports arena is an interesting one. And again, it's not use of controlled substances or psychoactive substances, et cetera, in sports is not a new phenomenon. Greek and Roman athletes in endurance sports, we have information that shows that they were using a variety of things to improve performance, to sustain endurance, etc. As early as 1904, we have the one case that probably remains, you know, when you look at the history of sports, use of drugs in sports, with a strychnine was given by a trainer to a cyclist and almost resulted in a fatality. Contemporary sports certainly strives for competition on a level playing field. We know that the WADA, which was the World Anti-Doping Agency, was created out of the Olympic movement, out of the anti-doping concerns in the 1990s. Let's take a look at military, and again, historical evidence and records that Kent mentioned. Going back to Roman times, we also know that alcohol and other psychoactive substances were used to sustain soldiers in terms of battle, endurance, alertness, etc., even to some extent in terms of trying to improve aggressiveness and a fighting spirit. We know that psychoactive substances were prescribed in the U.S. military, certainly into the 20th century, with regard to, again, the same kind of overall goals. Certainly, in the military, the term doping originated from the Dutch for the word dope, and in terms of, or dop. Described Zulu warriors using beverages that were, again, to enhance their battle powers. In 1980, the military kind of took a look at the survey that was being done by NIDA and did similar types of survey questions and investigation, if you will, in terms of looking at the prevalence of drug use among U.S. military personnel around the world. And that survey and the surveys that were done in subsequent years showed that there were almost a third of all military personnel on active duty at the time that answered those surveys in the affirmative that they had used an illicit drug, not medically authorized drug, within the past 30 days. You can see that at that point, certainly marijuana was the drug of choice. I think to some extent there was some relief in the military, because what they had really been targeting in the mid-1970s was heroin abuse, which was a critical issue for the military in terms of morale and readiness, and certainly as a part of the immediate post-Vietnam War era. Okay, Kent's going to take us on.
So finally, looking at the workplace, we go back, as all of these history sessions have been, to Ramazzini. And Ramazzini pondered, you know, what really causes drunkenness? He cited men whose duty it is all day long to rack off the wine and to empty grape skins from the vats, that they often became inebriated and suffer all the drawbacks of drunkenness merely from close application to their work. So he described a variety of symptoms. Looking at the high seas, backed a little bit to transportation, we know that sailors were issued tots of grog, not after a long working shift, but midships, after which they then had to climb up into the rigging to tend the sail and keep lookout. No wonder the call, "Man overboard," often rang out after people had consumed two or three tots of grog. In the modern workplace, most of the data that we still have today is largely anecdotal. We do know that the U.S. Postal Service did some classic studies in the 1980s. We learned, for example, that there's one drug that's not very frequently used in the Postal Service, and that is speed, right? But our colleague Greg Zwirling did publish an article on employees who were given drug tests before hired, without being told, without the supervisor being notified, and then 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 3.3 years later, studies were done showing that they had higher rates of discharge and absenteeism and being fired. Later, after the Journal of the American Medical Association retracted that article, because it had not been done under the proper human subject experimentation guidelines, the NIDA Division of Workplace Programs did their own survey. And here you see that people who currently, within the last month, were using illegal drugs did have three or more employers in the past year, more likely to have missed 2 days or skipped a day in the past month, more likely to have voluntarily left their job in the past year, twice as likely to have been fired, but they did not say that they were more likely to have had workplace accidents. So, you know, the bottom line to the question of the substance use and perhaps abuse by workers is that about 9% of full-time employees and 12.5% of part-time employees admit to having recently used an illegal drug. Most commonly was marijuana, and that was about at the same level of heavy alcohol use, which is defined as five or more drinks on five or more occasions in the past month. So the conclusion from this first segment is that we've learned a lot about psychoactive substances. They've been widely used for good and for ill effects, but over time the dangers and understanding of their impacts, of their adverse impact on the workplace, has been recognized and, thanks to recent surveys, quantified. So let's move on then to the second segment, which is substance abuse prevention. Pliny opined about how to prevent inebriation through consumption of bitter almonds and cabbage and radishes and such. We know that in the early colonial era, the U.S. per capita alcohol consumption rapidly rose. Why? Because in the early colonial days, there was no source of sugar. The famous and notable American hero Johnny Appleseed, in fact, planted apples along the routes of migrants so that they would be able to have a very bitter apple which would make alcoholic beverages. And so as alcohol could be produced, it was consumed, and it began to create a problem and then led to the beginning of suppressing the use of alcohol in the workplace. I'm not far from Williamsburg, and I once wandered into an apothecary shop there and saw a moral and physical thermometer, a scale in the progress of temperance and intemperance. And at the top, there were the positive benefits of temperance, health and wealth and serenity of mind and reputation and long life and happiness. And on the intemperance area, you would see serenity and perjury, obscenity, swearing, lying, burglary, and murder. And all kinds of epilepsy, dropsy, palsy, apoplexy, and death. So here was a thermometer in the colonial times that preceded by a century the temperance movement. And of course, then there was temperance. Lips that touch liquor shall not touch ours. And of course, then the enactment of temperance in 19. So, in turn, the temperance and intemperance movement led to a couple of people, Bill Wilson, Bill W., and Dr. Robert Smith, Dr. Bob, who started out with 6 basic steps, but they quickly expanded into the 12 steps that led to Alcoholics Anonymous. And finally, in a major medical breakthrough in 1956, the American Medical Association declared alcoholism to be an illness. So we saw the voluntary led, that's interesting. I think this computer's been drinking too much. All right, I tell you, there's nothing worse than a tipsy driver of a tipsy computer. So anyway, one day at a time, the peer-led support groups had significant help in pulling people out of rock bottom. A couple more slides, and then Donna's going to pick up in the modern era. But in 1906, the Smoking Opium Exclusion Act was one of those national legislations which ended opium dens. And the Pure Food and Drug Act required accurate labeling of the patent medicines, which led to a lot of the diminishing of them. The Harrison Narcotic Act forbade the sale of substantial doses of opiates and cocaine except by licensed doctors. And finally, in the 1930s, we had drug treatment with barbiturates and belladonna. There was the purge and puke belladonna cure, which added deliriance like atropine and scopolamine. And then there was the hot flash spiritual conversion, leading to speaking publicly about things like hot flashes. You want to pick up from there?
And so the federal regulations that, in terms of this kind of march on from the 1930s, there was the Marijuana Tax Act, and it did, even though it was not until the 1960s that we heard so much about this again, but even the act in 1937 identified marijuana as a gateway drug. So the whole issue that we're now facing as we look at rescheduling marijuana today, medical marijuana licensure, all of that kind of thing, really, in many ways, the same kind of issues in terms of is marijuana a gateway drug and therefore deserves a different classification, if you will, with regard to its dangers. In 1966, the Surgeon General's report on tobacco led to the warnings on cigarette packs and on commercials and all of that kind of thing. And certainly in 1970, the Comprehensive Drug Abuse Prevention and Control Act replaced all previous federal laws on narcotics and dangerous drugs. So that became kind of, again, an umbrella piece of legislation that was pulling this whole area together. And as you can see, the two key words, prevention, but also the second word, control, in terms of what was going to continue to be done by the federal government to control the negative impacts of drug abuse, drug misuse, drug use, et cetera. In 1986, the first of the federal regulations that were designed or were looking at the issue of drug use and abuse and its impact in workplaces was signed into law. This was Executive Order 12564, which really began drug testing, drug screening in the federal workplace. And so at that time, Reagan's words in signing that, President Reagan's words in signing that into law, I thought were significant, because don't forget, it was really the Reagan administration that came about with this, we're going to do a two-pronged approach to the scourge of illicit drugs in this country. We're going to do demand reduction, and we're going to do supply reduction in terms of through interdiction and all the other kinds of things that were still a part of the national strategy. So the 1986 executive order specifically said that the federal government, as the largest employer in the United States, would lead the way, set the example, by putting in place drug-free workplace program and drug screening, drug testing, as a means of detecting workers who were using prohibited substances. So that's really kind of what started the whole thing. In 1988, there was a kind of a companion piece of legislation that was designed for the private sector from a standpoint that the Anti-Drug Abuse Act, which did fund treatment and rehab and created at that time the Office of National Drug Control Policy. So it tried to go beyond just the federal employee workforce. Let's switch again to looking at sports in terms of what was going on in sports with regard to anti-doping efforts. It was in 1967 that, again, the case of the strychnine toxicity that I mentioned earlier that occurred again now, but still in the cycling industry, or in the cycling sport, and that would be a theme, if you will, of the early efforts by the International Olympic Committee and the International Sports Committee with regard to controlling and preventing the use of performance-enhancing and potentially dangerous drugs for athletes. So in 1967, that same year when that happened, the International Olympic Committee Medical Commission adopted its first list of prohibited substances. So it was in this era that the sports community decided that they were going to begin to formalize a program that was looking at prohibited substances in competitive sports. The military, looking at the same time period in the 1970s, so you can see the parallel that was what was occurring in workplace and general population legislation and regulations and initiatives for controlling illicit drug and other drug use and abuse, and the in sports at the same kind of era, and then in the military in the 1970s. In fact, I say that I wouldn't have worked for now 30 years with Dr. Peterson had it not been for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers putting together their nuclear power program and introduce what were called human reliability officers. And that was one of Dr. Peterson's first occupational medicine role as one of the the human reliability officers. And again, an emphasis, if you will, on fitness for duty, but certainly an emphasis on prevention, control, deterrence, detection of prohibited drugs. The Department of Defense Drug Abuse Prevention and Control Initiatives, notice the same phrase that was used in earlier legislation, prevention and control, included comprehensive education, awareness, urine drug testing, and as Kent mentioned briefly, the kind of the birth of the medical review officer, having a physician, in this case in the military, medical corps officers who would be directly involved in the drug screening program that was taking place and begun to take place in the 1970s. The military did adopt a zero tolerance policy for illicit drug use. And the phrase that you saw on posters all over the Navy, at least, was not on my watch, not on my ship, and not in my Navy. And, of course, later on we'll mention that it really was a very specific, tragic plane crash in the Navy on an aircraft carrier that really lit up the Department of Defense at the Pentagon in terms of saying, we have a problem. We can no longer just blame this, if you will, on soldiers, sailors, and others coming back from Vietnam and using drugs. It has spread and it has become endemic in the military in the military services. So Kent will now talk a little bit about substance abuse in the workplace, particularly in the private sector.
Okay, so in the early 1900s, we had companies like Sears in Chicago, Ford Motor Company, and those on the East and West Coast
that adopted industrial alcoholism programs, and these morphed in the 1950s into internal or in-house employee assistance programs. There was a national effort to create an occupational programs branch within the government, and there were two consultants per state, which were known as the Thunder and Hundred. Then in the 1980s, companies began to outsource employee assistance programs to external programs that included managed mental health care and work-life balance. So you see the growth of EAPs from a handful in the 1940s to more than 12,000 in 1985. And finally, the new role of a substance abuse professional was created by a certain person working in the office of the Secretary of the Department of Transportation, who happens to be sitting next to me. So our conclusion in terms of substance abuse prevention is that increasingly comprehensive and effective prevention and treatment programs have evolved. Now, very quickly turning to the question of substance abuse screening, there were questionnaires developed like the Michigan Alcohol Screening Test, and there was the emergence of technology. So ideas and technology joined with the development of immunoassay screening, and that led initially to screening based simply on immunoassay with a lot of false positives. And so as a result, professional societies developed a two-test standard of an initial screening test using immunoassay and then finally followed by GCMS or other confirmatory methods. As far as sports, the cycling and football sports introduced doping tests in 1986 in Mexico. There were the beginning of testing of the Olympic people and the creation of WADA. In the military, the immunoassay tests for heroin in Vietnam led to a uniform, widespread collection with mandatory tests throughout the military. The crash on the Nimitz carrier that you just referred to, Donna, you know, certainly got the attention as six crew members tested positive for marijuana. There was a commission that led to an overhaul of laboratories throughout the military. And in the private sector, you know, the executive order of drug-free workplace programs was copied because the fact was that the federal standard, the DOT standard, was such an excellent model that it was copied and mimicked and adopted reflexively by private employers. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission had a different set of standards, and of course the DOT standards became really what we consider the gold standard. So private employer studies showed that drug testing did in fact lead to reduction. And at this point, there's about 28 million workers who are screened, 11 under federal authority and more than 20 under non-federal. We see that as the size of a company increases, so does the likelihood of drug testing, particularly for pre-employment, but also random testing, almost up to 50%. We know there's different types of workplace screening. We know the names of these, the random, the post-accident. We know there's federally regulated panels that are narrow and much broader non-federally regulated panels. MRO training and certification began with ACOEM's predecessor, and now at this point, as you said in your introduction, ACOEM has held more than 150 training programs and trained more than 16,000 MROs. ACOEM helped to launch the credentialing of MROs by helping to found MROCC, and that was such a good voluntary idea that now many states, the military, not the military, but DOT and the Department of Health and Human Services, have also adopted that. We've seen over the years the expansion of drug panels, changing of drug cutoff levels, the emergence of specialty specimen validity testing because of attempts to beat the test, and finally instant point of collection kits. So we're seeing the technology continue to evolve. You know, we have issues involving the collision now of state versus federal authority, with particularly evident with the existence of medical marijuana. The real issue is functional ability. It's not the presence of drugs that's the problem, it's the impairment. It's the limitation of functional ability. But there's lots of other things that can cause that: fatigue, sleep apnea, et cetera, et cetera. So those are the real issues. So in conclusion, has drug screening been effective? And this one chart from Quest Diagnostics shows that the percent of all specimens submitted to Quest has dropped from 18% in 1987 to now between 3 and 4%. And the federal testing shows that the levels are under 1%. So I would suggest that we have, in fact, developed an effective technology that has been a deterrent and has led to the reduction of drug use. So in conclusion, the emerging technology of immunoassay allowed for drug screening programs to protect workplace safety and health, and at the same time implement humane medical approaches that deter, detect, treat, and rehabilitate drug users. A lot of material. We went through it very quickly. Thank you, Donna. Thank you all.
Thanks so much. In the interest of time, I think we'll wait for questions at the end. And I'll invite Dr. Lepke up now to give his talk on health and productivity management evolution while I pull his slides up.
It's a pleasure and a privilege to be with you this morning, and thank you, Judith, and the other excellent speakers, and Bob for the invitation to do this session. I'm going to be talking about more recent history than what I think the other speakers have a significant longer historical perspective on their subject, no disclosures, but I'm going to do it in a timeline. And you can go and do a Google search on health and productivity management, and it comes up with 173 million hits. Now, I read all of them, and we have about an eight-hour session here, so you know you're going to want that stretch break. But we'll go through this timeline very quickly so that you see the perspective on this. And I've used this slide from Dr. Kathy Bossi. She presented this on Sunday in her presentation, but I thought it really captured the essence of what was driving this emergence of health and productivity management. Number one, the inexorable rise in U.S. healthcare costs and a huge waste of about a third of those costs, and prevention opportunities that could eliminate about 30 to 50% of the illness burden driving those costs. The massive safety and quality issues in the U.S. healthcare system, leading to 200,000 to 400,000 deaths per year and 10 to 20 times the sublethal events in hospitals and the healthcare system. Tragedy. And then the business value of health as a key driver of other corporate priorities. For Dow Chemical, and we see this now with many employers, they really see health as a performance driver, leading to safety, employee performance and engagement, loyalty, morale improvements, attraction and retention of employees, corporate reputation, reliability, and sustainability. And in fact, in talking with Dr. Bossi and I know many others in this room, we really see kind of a transition over time from industrial medicine and through occupational medicine on to occupational health and ultimately corporate health, which is an integration of health and safety management, disease management, productivity management, pharmaceutical management, healthcare quality and cost management, value-based benefit design, and becoming a chief health officer managing the health assets and human capital of the workforce. So, let's start in 1892 with Mark Twain. When I actually did a literature review, Gary Johns had a good treatise on all this, and he mentioned that Mark Twain, in the book The American Claimant, used the term presentee for the first time that we could find it in the literature. Now, at that time, the definition was as an antonym for absentee, so excellent attendance at work. And then you can see even how others over the years continued to use that. However, Dr. Burton, who's a giant in the health and productivity management industry, actually defined presenteeism as the decrement of performance with remaining at work while impaired with health problems. And you can see others, including a summit group of many in the room, where we actually defined it that the worker is present at work but functioning at a lower level of work performance due to an inadequately managed health risk or health condition. Some of the early studies, and again, it's not going to be an exhaustive review, although the handout, I have a much more annotated bibliography of many articles, but Brady and others, Burton, Jeff Harris, and even when we did the SOTAC meeting in Toronto and ended up publishing this, but many articles, including one that Dr. Paul Brandt Ralph and Dr. Wayne Burton and Bob McCunney did as a special issue in JOEM in 2001 on health and productivity management. So, what's the definition? Really, health and productivity management is a systematic approach designed to quantify, evaluate, and optimize a company's investment in the health and safety of its workforce. It addresses the health and safety of the workforce as a business performance driver. That is, an investment to be leveraged versus a cost to be justified. In fact, I heard one employer say, we're now beginning to recognize the benefits of health rather than just look at the cost of health benefits. So what about some of the tools, the measurement tools? Starting in the 2000s, we actually pulled together an ACOEM expert panel, and Pam Heimel and Kathy Bossi, George Anstett, Joe Fortuna, others, where we looked at the definitions as well as some of the measurement tools that were out there that could not only allow people to measure presenteeism and absenteeism, but begin to manage it and see how you're making an impact. So really, it ended up with the gold standard of self-reported data, like health risk assessments, and tools that could be embedded within those to measure absenteeism and presenteeism related to chronic conditions and health risks. And you'll remember there were, and continue to be today, several validated tools like Ron Kessler's, the Health and Productivity Performance Questionnaire, Deb Lerner's WLQ, and we looked at it as to whether they were practical, what the science and evidence supported it with, how it assessed different parameters, the applicability across industries and industry size, and whether it really supported decision making by being able to translate it into financial terms. And so in terms of some of the chronic condition issues, I call this the 5575, the global drivers of mortality due to unhealthy lifestyle behaviors. Five lifestyle behaviors, physical inactivity, poor nutrition, smoking, alcohol, and medicine non-adherence, driving five chronic conditions, diabetes, heart disease, lung disease, cancer, and mental illness, leading to 75% of all deaths worldwide. And in the U.S., 75% of all the dollars spent in our healthcare system are related to people with one or more chronic disease. And we have 150 million Americans that have one or more chronic diseases. And 27% of the rise in the healthcare costs has been associated to the increase in obesity rates. It's not just a more expensive MRI or a more expensive hospital bed day. It's that we're using too many hospital bed days and too many MRIs because of this burden of illness. And yet, less than 5 cents of each healthcare dollar is spent on prevention. Specifically, the need for diabetes prevention and evidence-based care of diabetics in the U.S. is a phenomenal set of statistics. 86 million Americans have pre-diabetes, and yet less than 10% of them know it. 29 million Americans have diabetes. Only 21 million of those are diagnosed. Of those diagnosed, 17 million are treated, and of those treated, only 8.5 million are controlled. Now, that's a travesty in our American healthcare system this era. What about healthiness, and how does that impact health and productivity? Well, we all know that over half of all the causes of death in the United States are related to lifestyle. In fact, one of my professors in my residency said, largely how we live dictates how we die in the United States. And only 20% of the impact being heredity, so we can't blame our parents for everything. And yet 10% being related to the healthcare system and those statistics I showed you in the beginning. Now, Dr. D. Eddington, who really has been one of the fathers of corporate health and wellness and health and productivity, shows that across age bands, it's really the health risks that drive the costs. So health risk trumps age. If you look at a person that's between 35 and 44 and their high health risk, they have the same amount of annual medical claims costs as a person that's older than 75 but is low health risk. And Dr. Burton and others have shown that as you increase the number of health risks, you increase the presenteeism problems, the absenteeism problems, and no, that's not sexually transmitted disease, that's short-term disability. And so in 2006, actually, several of us worked on, with ACOEM, a blueprint for health that really developed as an online toolkit, which has a wealth of information on health and productivity management. It's free to all ACOEM members. And at the same time, we began our first course in health and productivity management. We called it the Health and Productivity Clinic and had a toolkit. Again, these resources are available to all ACOEM members and are free. And we're currently working on a new e-learning set of course, and many of the faculty are in the room here, that is a collaborative between ACOEM, Underwriter Lab, Integrated Health and Safety Institute, and the University of Illinois. And that's going to be on population health management, health and productivity management, integrating health and safety in the workplace. So what about the economic impact? The bigger problem for employers, and everybody's seen this slide, but it's the full cost of poor health. It's not just the personal health costs, medical pharmacy costs. It's these health-related productivity costs that are the bigger portion of the iceberg that are sinking many corporate ships related to the absenteeism and presenteeism. We found in a study that we did, ACOEM and Integrated Benefits Institute, Dr. Kessler at Harvard, analyzing over 1 million employee lives data, that for every $1 of medical pharmacy costs that these employers were paying out, they had around $2.3 in health-related productivity costs. And in fact, in that study, we showed that the top 10 medical conditions driving total cost is different than that what drives medical pharmacy costs. Depression was number one on the list. Obesity, number two. And you can see in the red, which is medical costs, and the yellow pharmaceutical costs, it's a fairly minimal amount of dollars, but the vast costs come in the presenteeism and absenteeism. I think today you can see depression, anxiety, gastroesophageal reflux disease. I mean, several of these are stress-related in large part. Now, I think stress may be one of the biggest toxic exposures of our society and in workplaces that we see today. And then we talked about many of the employers, they want to make sure that there's a good ROI when you do health and productivity management initiatives. But we found that there's a translation beyond ROI, but this study that everyone's familiar with from Baker et al. In the Journal of Health Affairs, showing that in a meta-analysis, they found on programs that were evidence-based, comprehensive, workplace wellness programs, there was a 6-to-1 ROI, $3.27 in medical pharmacy savings and $2.73 in absenteeism savings. But many employers began to expand their own definition of what it was worth to them, not just impacting their medical costs as an ROI. Looking at some of the other leading indicators, that if you pay attention to these leading indicators, they will generate the lagging indicator of financial return. And so that includes participation and engagement of the workforce. The higher the participation engagement, the better the return on investment. Is the population getting their appropriate preventive screening indicators? Are you tracking the health risks in the population and showing that they're improving or what's happening? Are those with conditions like diabetes getting the appropriate evidence-based guideline monitoring and improvement? Is there better or lower hospitalization and emergency room visits, health and presenteeism, absenteeism impacts, and shareholder value? As a matter of fact, I had the privilege of working with an employer that was public, 58,000 employees. And they found that they currently, that year, had, on average, 8 days per employee in health-related productivity loss. Now, about half of those days absenteeism and about half presenteeism. Now, this employer measured productivity and presenteeism to the nth degree. This employer was MGM Mirage. And they measured hands dealt per hour, and I mean things that you can imagine in terms of productivity, and had the data. So the CFO said, what if we could get back 1 day out of this average of 8 days of health-related productivity loss per year per employee? Well, in their instance, that was worth $18.8 million to their EBITDA, bottom line. Now, they traded at a 13-time multiple on Wall Street, so the CFO said that's worth $244 million in estimated market cap increase. They had 292 million shares outstanding, so it was worth 84 cents in additional per share value. And we know how many public companies actually struggle to get a nickel a share in their increase of their share value. In the late 2000s, then, it really emerged more and more about population health. And you've heard many speakers talking about how to engage the whole population and the whole person. So wellness began to move beyond just the physical domain into well-being, physical, emotional, mental, social, spiritual aspects, and the whole continuum of prevention. Primary, secondary, and tertiary. It's not sufficient to just manage those with chronic conditions on the right side. We have to move upstream, as Dee Eddington says, and keep the healthy people healthy. That's how you really get sustainable cost reductions over time, because otherwise you just have more people falling into the river of illness each year. And then we spend so much time and effort trying to pull them back out before they go over a waterfall of complications and comorbidities. And the CDC has found that 80% of heart disease and type 2 diabetes, as well as 40% of cancer, are preventable if Americans just did not use tobacco, ate healthier, and exercised more regularly. Now, we all know that. Our grandmother told us that. The problem is it says easy and does hard for too many people. And they'll pay attention to their pet health more than themselves. Now, Dr. Roizen is the chairman at the Cleveland Clinic Wellness Institute, and he has reviewed the literature, and you can see the references, New England Journal of Medicine articles, others, and found that there are five health factors that result in 33 to 50% less lifetime health care costs in those people that adhere to these five factors. And if 75% of Americans have these health characteristics, between $600 billion and $1 trillion could be saved per year in our current health care costs. Well, there's been a lot of debate in the last couple of 3 years as to whether workplace wellness really works. And I think rightfully so in a lot of the discussions is that it does not work if it's a random acts of wellness. It has to be a comprehensive, evidence-based program. But if you do that, that it will work, and you will generate an ROI, and it's been shown repeatedly. There's also been some political factors that have affected the health and productivity management timeline. The Affordable Care Act that everyone's familiar with, it set forth a national prevention strategy. We actually, at ACOEM, were given the opportunity to provide some testimony and input into that. They have put forth employer-based wellness program incentives and accountable care organizations and patient-centered medical home initiatives. Now, I think everybody's familiar with them, but those are care models that make physicians and hospitals more accountable. They're outcomes-oriented, performance-based, aligning incentives around better quality and lower cost and sharing savings. And including workplaces in ACOs and medical home development is logical because we know work impacts health as well as health impacts work. People don't leave their health risks on the doorstep at home when they come to work and vice versa. But employers have unique infrastructure advantages that could help these types of initiatives. In fact, we just recently published a proceedings from a summit session that was focused on transforming workplace health and safety through accountable care organizations and patient-centered medical home, new pathways for employers. And again, that's available on the ACOEM website. It's a follow-on to an article that Dr. McClellan was the lead author in 2012, and we're seeing an increased awareness and interest in combining and integrating the workplace, even the primary care arena, the public health arena, and the home. So what about integrating health and safety, health promotion, and health protection? Todd Hone, who's in the room, is the executive director of the Underwriter Labs Integrated Health and Safety Institute. And he had an analysis of data nationwide, and it showed that the average cost of work comp injury was $7,000 in that particular database. But if a person had one comorbid condition, it cost $13,000 on average. If they had two comorbid conditions, it was $30,000. If they had three comorbid conditions, it was $90,000. So obviously this issue of how health can impact those costs and needing to address integrating traditionally independent health protection and health promotion activities to create synergy and enhance the overall health and well-being of the workforce. And when we say integrating, it's not necessarily meaning they have to report to the same person vertically in the organization, but integrating the strategies of health and safety are important. In fact, Dr. Fabius and others of us have published an article looking at the Corporate Health Achievement Award-winning companies and how they performed in the stock market compared to the S&P 500. And you can see clearly, and this was even more evidence with three articles published in January in JOEM that supported the same issue. Now, I will say, obviously, there are limitations to the studies, and you can't say that it's causative. But it is correlative, it appears. So I think there's going to be more interest in this arena. Aging workforce that we're all aware of, and many people even working past 65, and older workers face more health challenges, more chronic conditions, more disabling conditions, higher risk on the job injury. The health and safety for an aging workforce is a gateway to improve employee engagement, performance, and greater satisfaction with work. And again, there was an article that we published, and Dr. Heimel and others participating in that. Now, what about global? These are not just U.S. issues. The World Economic Forum says that the impact on both advanced economies as well as developing countries from the silent epidemics of chronic illness is a critical global risk. Chronic illness is destructive and debilitating to individuals as well as nations, and the only sustainable pathway to improved health is through prevention. And the World Health Organization went even further, saying that chronic non-communicable diseases deliver a two-punch blow to development. They cause billions of dollars in losses of national income, and they push millions of people below the poverty line each and every month. It's no exaggeration to describe the situation as an impending disaster, a disaster for health, for societies, and most of all, for national economies. The health of a nation is linked to the wealth of a nation. We actually launched in 2013 a new organization, the International Occupational Medicine Society Collaborative. It's an organization of the organizations like ACOEM around the world in the various countries. And we have had proceedings that come out from each annual meeting looking at the common areas of interests and issues, and when next meeting is in Amsterdam. But this is one of the fundamental elements that we see worldwide, is how the health of the workforce is inextricably linked to the productivity and performance of businesses, wherever you are in the world. Regardless of whether you may have a national health service that's supposedly paying for the medical care, or whether it's an employer-based like in the U.S., the fundamental common causeway is how health and the burden of illness and risk that's leading to a lot of lower performance and lower productivity has to be held back. Well, we've recently had work to create an integrated health and safety index. And this, again, relates to the companies that had the Corporate Health Achievement Award. And we decided there needs to be some new metrics. Let's align those with actually a new way of measuring business value. And so we decided to align the new metrics with the Dow Jones Sustainability Index domains. And they have three domains that at least public companies are used to reporting on. And those are the economic, environmental, social domains. So we put that through the lens of integrated health and safety and established an index score of high performing companies. And actually, some of the metrics in those domains for the economic include how that company's leadership and management and the culture of health commitment is, what their costs are, how they integrate, and for the environmental, whether it's a healthy and safe environment, and for the social, how engaged are the workers in prevention and wellness, and is their corporate social responsibility impacting community health? In there, I mean, I think some are involved with the Institute of Medicine's initiative, linking how employers can be the spark that ignites community health issues. And with that, then standardized metrics, and this is the last couple of slides, but it has a carefully calibrated set of metrics in this index. This is published in an article in JOEM from May of 2015, if you want more detail around it. But one of the encouraging things is, in just in this past year, we've actually seen interest by insurance companies in this integrated health and safety index, both work comp insurance companies and group health insurance companies, that they may be willing to actually give employers premium discounts, depending on how they score, showing their investment in the health and safety of their workers. The other thing is, we're seeing interest by the investor financial community, where they're beginning to say, this may well be an index that we want to look at and decide which companies we're going to be putting more money into because of a sustainable, healthy and safe workforce. I think ultimately employers pursuing a high index score for integrated health and safety may yield the ultimate sustainability strategy, leading to healthier, safer workers that are more engaged, resilient, and productive. So we've come through the timeline, and I might just say I think we are finally on the threshold of moving beyond our reactive illness-based sick care system that we have to a more proactive wellness-based true health system. And a lot of it's going to be built from a cornerstone of health and productivity management and on the pillars of prevention. So do well, be well. Thank you.